not only was he owning the work that he was collecting, but he was also representing the work that he was actually presenting in the show as well, which is a complete travesty. How many of you guys went to the MoCA Jeffrey Art Show? Do you know, does anyone know the reasons why Jeffrey Deitch left? Is there any kind of discussion that anybody knows? Anything? It was one of the most successful shows. They never ever successfully at the gate charged $10 for individuals to come out and pay a ticket fee into a particular museum. The show was such a travesty that he was making money from the gate, from individuals who knew nothing, charging an incredible amount of money. It was probably the biggest amount of money that he was generating from the fees at the museum. And most museums are considered, should be considered free. But this individual charged $10 per individual. It was the highest grossing gate museum event in the city of Los Angeles, in the history of the museums of contemporary art. Jeffrey Deitch also, one of some other outstanding violations that he did against culture was that Catherine Opie tried to keep the education director on staff. But Jeffrey Deitch decided that he didn't really need an educational director because his interest was only the interest of having the work sold to select few elite collectors. So it was basically a director that sold his collection to collectors. No interest in any outreach. Does anybody know much about museums here?
Yeah.
I'd like to get some responses from you guys. What do you think about museum outreach? And how important is an educational director? Can you step up?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I don't like outreach. Because if you're reaching out, it means that they're not there.
There you go. That's a perfect response, isn't it, guys? Go ahead.
Oh, so having started in museums as an outreach coordinator, and being the taste of the month, it was really problematic for me because I felt like it was targeting an audience, which when I think of a target, you know.
Target being
a point of
a group that wasn't represented.
Yeah, well, targeting to me means that you are focusing on somebody that's outside of your inner circle. And so that was.
Can we use the word racism?
Well, yeah, straight up racist, but
racism introduced into the words of museums, guys.
Yeah. It's classes too. But
classes? And what else? What's another word that we can possibly use with regard to how the demographic groups are not being properly represented in the museums? Now, most people think that museums should be open to a populist dialogue. Jeffrey Deitch thought it was as well, but he was only self-serving himself. I guarantee you that Jeffrey Deitch was given the opportunity to either get fired or resign. No one thought that Jeffrey Deitch would leave. I did. I believed he was going to leave. Now, let's talk about the conflict of interest at the Museum of Contemporary Art. How many people know that there was a conflict of interest at yours truly, the Museum of Contemporary Art, which has an incredible great history started by Richard Koshelak during the 70s? Does anybody know about the conflict of interest?
Was it that they were glorifying street art? Was it that one? Was it that show that you're talking about?
That was it.
Yeah.
I call that show not Art of the Streets. I call it Cash and Money Streets. Anybody have any ideas about what your thoughts about Cash and Money Streets? Don't you think it makes a better title? What's your name?
My name's Anderson. And when I visited Art of the Streets, I actually ran into Shepard Fairey, and he was giving John Krasinski a tour of the exhibit. So if you imagine that as a...
And tell us who John Krasinski is.
He's an actor in The Office, one of the lead roles. So he might have some idea.
What's your thoughts about that?
Well, Deitch is usually associated with celebrity, and
So can you say that you were exploiting a particular indigenous form of a language, and not only are you, but you're also exploiting it and bringing it where you're not even representing the particular demographic of those groups of people. How many people know Chaka?
Chaka. Which Chaka?
The graffiti artist Chaka.
Oh, no.
Does anybody know who Chaka is? Omar, do you know who Chaka is? Why don't you tell us who Chaka is?
Chaka, graffiti, a lot of LA. It's everywhere.
Yeah.
He was a voice of LA. Was Chaka in the Museum of Contemporary Art, Art of the Street Show?
No.
That's kind of funny, isn't it? You have one of the greatest Latino Chicano who grew up in the projects. Jeffrey Deitch didn't choose not to include his work in the exhibition. I wonder why. Conflict of interest, let's get back to that. Conflict of interest was because Jeffrey Deitch represented the same very art that he was owned, and also that he also represented the artist that he was. That's a big no-no in the art world. So this is gonna be a journey exploring a performance that addresses these things, and it's gonna be presented as an expose. And thanks everybody for coming in here. We do it through performance art, we do it through Milli Vanilli lip syncing, and then we'd like to get you involved in this conversation. And we'd also like to thank the ESMO museum staff for actually giving us the opportunity to provide an alternative to Art of the Streets, which is called Scratch. So let's begin with scratching the surface. Ready? Let's go. Put that up loud. Let's go. Oh.
You're live 24/7 radio.
Great phone calls.
I'm here letting y'all know that I fell down and I can't get it up.
The most fucked up things about the art world. Let's talk about the top five.
So much in me that is untrue. I looked at you.
For you and your lives only, guys. Only for you. Homie, for your lives only. You can see what no one else can see. It's just publicity, guys. Homie, for you. The love of cash I need to hide. Just greeting me, guys.
Homie, for you.
Wow, what a way of packaging indigenous demographics. So let's bring up, this is an introduction that talks about, let's take that from the top again.
So with a final new line which raises new awareness, it's the famous street artist who would like to announce his latest performance through a latest biting commentary, one which questions our so-called elitist culture. We question. You have been personally invited to a closed performance, not dared to be open to the public, as the next premiere performance is too controversial to be revealed and explicit. It is the famous street artist who will direct and participate in the performance, which reveals an expose into the integrity of culture in question through many of its historical transgressions and travesties, which detail such passwords into self-serving elitist missions of former director Jeffrey Deitch with his mocha graffiti exhibition Art in the Streets, also known as Cash In on the Streets.
I
love that. Performance today will be in a closed backroom space at Mocha, the controversial performance by the famous street artist, is a social satirist with commitment to the cause of inquiry and dissent, who has previously presented as a real theater of question, which in sarcasm celebrates a cultural decline, our end of history, art, theatrical performance, and its cult of personality through self-cast characters and self-realized script. It is the street artist who has previously cast himself in a denigrated role of playing as the lead role for a fictitious pop band.
Let's get that MC Kiss character up.
MC Kiss My Ass.
MC Kiss My Ass. It's a performance I put together for
Personas such as Jack Inglebox, as well as for the street artist who delivers Master Pizza. Street artist references classic name brand songs of our time, adapted, advised, and human conglomerate, and elevated media within diverse social platforms and cultural analogies. The street artist's efforts is to shed light on the darkness of grief. The famous street artist invites you to engage in a collaboration of the journey, which led to tested charges against the dark history of our culture in its time.
Top five most fucked up things in the art world. This is an educational class. Does anybody have any guesses about some of the most fucked up things in the art world? Let's start with number five. Everybody knows Banksy, but how many people know Black Lerac? Looks familiar to me, guys, doesn't it? Looks like a ripoff to me. Everybody agree?
Yep.
Wow, how surprising. You know how much Banksy gets for his artwork on the secondary market?
1.5 million.
How much?
1.5 million.
1.5 million. You guys are artists, curators. Where do I see justice? Where do I see equity? You guys are being ripped off. Let's go to the next slide. Can you tell the difference between Black Lerac and Banksy? This is your fucking culture, guys. Your fucking culture. Banksy ripped off Black Lerac. It's packaged by Madison Avenue public relations firm to rip you fucking guys off. Fuck you, Banksy. Fuck you, Fakesy. Fuck you, Fakesy. Fuck you, Fakesy. Fuck you.
I'd like to sleep with my ass pushed up against you.
Put that up. We're gonna talk and make some characterizations and accusations and level some contested charges against our friends out there in the fucking art world. Put it up. Let's go. Put that fucker up. Hammerman Dieta. Anybody know Hammerman Dieta? Who knows Hammerman Dieta? One person knows Hammerman Dieta. How many fucking people know Hammerman Dieta? Two people know Hammerman Dieta. Two fucking people know Hammerman Dieta. What fucking happened to Hammerman Dieta? What? What? Who pushed her out the fucking window? Kyle Andre. Who the fuck is Kyle Andre? So guys, back to art. Two people in a master's class, graduate class, Anna Mendieta. pushed out the 37th floor window of Manhattan, 1986. Indigenous Latina. Her husband was never charged. And he continued on with his artwork.
Half asleep.
Let's go on with number two. Anybody know that? Let's keep that picture right there. Let's go. Keith Haring and Little LA 2. Get to that part about the introduction about... Did we mention that? Did we record that? Yeah, I think we did. Let's get out to the next one. Let's get to the vocal, the introduction of LA 2. And it's the next one. Can we hook that up? LA 2, Little Angel, Angel Ortiz, 13-year-old, 1980s, New York City. Does anybody know who LA 2 is? One person.
Wow.
Here we go. Put it up.
Banksy mocks the oppressed and poor of the ghetto.
No, that's not the one. Blocks. Put it.
The recent stencil placed by Banksy's team, Ghetto for Life, is considered a slurred statement.
Let's go to Banksy.
By native New York City Bronx borough.
That's the top
politician.
Go to the next one. Sorry,
the
guys.
Two, the Bankster.
No, that Bankster.
AKA the double dash bust. Mocha's mission under Jeffrey Dyke was provincial. Number three. The deterring silent.
That's it, right there.
The next deal.
Right there. Okay, here we go. Play it.
Who's.
Let's get back to Little Angel. Here's a story about Little Angel and Angel Ortiz, LA 2. He's about 35, 40 years old right now, New York City.
Who's the tab corrupt markets? Number three.
The corrupt markets of the art world.
Silent exploitation, Latino partner, LA 2. Was born Angel Ortiz in 1967 in New York tenement housing, where he painted his tag the name of LA 2.
LA 2.
LA 2 is the tag or alias taken by Angel Ortiz, who was a young graffiti artist from the Lower East Side of New York City. LA stood for Little Angel. He also occasionally used the LA Rock or LA 2.
LA Rock.
When he was about 13, Ortiz was befriended by the elder Keith Haring, who had a fetish for Latino boys. They collaborated on a number of works from 1981.
Sounds like exploitation to me, doesn't it?
Haring felt Ortiz's tag style stood out from others in the New York graffiti writers. It seemed to resemble Asian calligraphy. As Haring and Ortiz began combining their styles to create an overall surface of intermingling lines and forms. Haring said all the work that Angel and I did was about surface and usually covered.
Sure was.
Transformed the object that it applied to. Together they
covered
a halo painting, plaster sculptures, real objects, or room-sized installations with a kind of graffiti writing. It was a mixture of contemporary and ancient symbols. But now LA 2 is still a young artist, unrecognizable with the city of
unrecognizable, unknown.
Miqua, who was never given recognition in the art world or the art market, instead chose to selectively give the name and the authority to Keith Haring. For LA 2, name recognition and identity was never received from Keith Haring. Today, Angel is just a lost footnote in the annals of history books, without any visibility, living in the shadows of an individual who had exploited him, calling himself a friend. And now, the work is exhibited at Deitch Monuments.
What a surprise, huh? Jeffrey Deitch, the work showing the exploitation of Keith Haring. How much does Keith Haring's work sell on the secondary market? Does anybody have an idea? Give me an estimate.
Millions.
Okay.
500,000?
Whatever.
Whatever.
Money's no object, right? Do you ever see Keith Haring's name associated with Little Angel Ortiz on the secondary market?
No.
Hell
no,
fucking
tell
no.
Us about it.
What's that?
I said no, tell us about it.
Let's have you out here, let's talk about it. Come on.
No, thank you.
No, come on. You seem to have an opinion. That
I don't have any opinion. I want to hear you talk about it.
Okay, I'll tell you about it. You know, people turn a blind eye to culture. And that's bullshit. Because this is your fucking culture, guys. Play it on. So Little Angel gets no secondary money market on the fucking work that he created with Keith Haring. Is that fair?
No.
What?
No.
No. He happens to be Boricua, Puerto Rican from New York. So we have a woman who's thrown out of her window, dies, thrown out by a minimalist artist. Do we want to keep that fucking artist out of jail so we can score some money for the art market? I would say so. Let's not charge Carl Andre. Let's get him the best fucking lawyers. Now we have Little Angel, whose work is not sold on the secondary fucking market, guys, but Keith Haring is. And he's not getting the recognition, and he'll never get the recognition. What a travesty. How barbaric. How fucked up. And that's only number four. Fuck you, Fancy. Turn it up. Fuck you, Fancy. Turn it up. Fuck you, Fancy. 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 Turn it up. Turn it up. Turn it up. Get a light for sale, motherfuckers. Let's sell some Get over light. Yeah. Who's that by? Macy. Making fun of the African American communities. The indigenous Latino, Chicanos, Boricua. Because you know what? They're fucking lights for sale. So let's make fun of those fucking people. Turn it up. To my bass. Playing cool, and I dig all jive until they stop yelling out, get over live. Playing cool, dig all jive until they start exploiting, get over live. Get over live. Get over live. Get over live. Let's go. Number three. Hook up number three. Top five more fucked up things in the art world. Anybody know about this? Did you know about it?
I am not.
Did you know about it, Karen? Any of the transgressive acts?
Yes, I was the one you mentioned so far.
Did you know about it?
I'm not sure what you guys are talking about.
He's asking which of these transgressions.
Bring that back to me.
Oh, yes.
Let's go to the next one. Number three. Pretty entertaining.
Number four. Murdered by art. This is a story about the Sunday Street death of Black Oakland, the art world MF Mandia Fest. In the wee hours of the morning, September 8th, 1980. Number four, murdered by art. This is a story about the Sunday Street death of Black Oakland, the art world MF Mandia Fest. In the wee hours of morning of September 8, 1985, Carl Andre, a successful avant-garde sculptor who was a minimalist, argued with his artist wife, Anna Mendieta, who was
cultural masquerade.
Somehow, she went out the window.
A little bit.
This was Mr. Carl Andre's phrase for his emergency call to 911.
Let's go to the next one.
Okay, 34th floor, Greenwich Village.
I think we're here. We talked about
she
this, right?
She committed suicide.
Yeah.
Okay,
well,
Okay, thank you.
Since she only weighed 92 pounds compared to his 170 pounds,
There was no eyewitness.
Let's go to Cultural Masquerade, guys. Let's go to Cultural Masquerade. That song.
No. Then the explosive thud of anger gets his body.
Let's go to the last Cultural Masquerade. So the last song is Cultural Masquerade because isn't that what it's all about? Ready? Here we go. If you guys want to go ahead, I'd be happy to meet and talk to you. Personally, take meetings with you and give you a little education on culture. Put it up. Because they're selling you a phony and one-act play, Cultural Masquerades. Let's go. Are we really happy here?
Are we able to have freedom to say that someone's cash and greed got in the way?
Someone's cash and greed got in the way.
In time, I hear lies. No matter how hard I see. We're lost in the cultural game we play. And are we really happy here today with this cultural game you say? Hiring a phony one-act play.
Phony one-act play.
Hey, searching but just finding. Misunderstanding if you dare. You're lost in a cultural masquerade.
You're lost
in a cultural masquerade.
You're lost
in a cultural masquerade.
You're lost in a cultural masquerade. Thank you guys for coming. We want to appreciate, give our thanks and gratitude to the Esmo staff. We want to thank Karen Moss. Appreciate it. Thank you, Karen. Thank you, everybody. I hope I was able to provide greater insight. There's many cultural transgressions that take place, but nobody dares talks about it at all. And I think we should talk about it, don't you? That's what this conversation's all about. Thank you so much. Thanks for being a part of the cultural masquerade, the cultural games we play, the phony one-act play game, Shepherd Phony, Fakesy, fuck you, Fakesy. Thank you. Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Holly and Chelsea. Appreciate it. Appreciate you giving us our time. I'd be happy to meet with you guys and talk to you about it, yeah.
Okay. Well, the students have another class that they need to move on to soon, so could you just tell us now?
There's so many transgressions that take place. I mean, I can just sit around and
talk.
Well,
what are your other topics?
I would say that the thing that was really important that was is the exploitation of the banks and market, which is essentially, it's a self-fulfilling market. It's a back-end market that you can actually sell and you can actually acquire the work, represent the work. So when an individual says to you that they're a guardian of culture, I would begin to suspect that is a word, a tautological word, that is a motive for what that individual's particular motive is to exploit. So one of the most important things, and let me bring that out because I have a Google Drive that actually has that.
I think these are the five. This is the first one. The second one. This would be the fourth. This is sort of the fifth.
So, Fancy, Herring, Mentieta.
0-2.
0-2.
And the fifth one was, listen.
We didn't talk about Shepherd Herring.
Shepherd Herring. Okay.
Oh, it's the exploitation of the museum as a vehicle for basically using museums, which is a public institution, to basically gratuitously serve your own account. I think that's a great idea. Let's make millions by exploiting the museums.
Yeah, so wait a minute. So first, I just want to put some historical context on this. Museums were not originally created for the public.
Absolutely.
So it wasn't until the late
70s. 80s,
no, it was the late 80s when museums sort of
transformed. Well, the Citibank.
No, but let me just say this. It was in the late 80s when museums actually took on a policy of inclusion in the language of outreach became popular in the American Association for Museums. That's when it actually happened. So here's the thing. Institutions like museums were set up to conserve and to collect.
Right.
They did not care about education. They did not care about community access. They didn't care about anything other than conserve and collect, collect and conserve. When there was a call for inclusion, it was about a social movement, a political action that was aligned with affirmative action and all that crap, that really didn't work.
Right.
You know, and multiculturalism was the language of it. So historically, museums were not a public institution. It wasn't until they created public institutions that people then began to question and want to hold institutions accountable. But it didn't happen from a populist call for action. It happened from educators who were in conflict because they were being educated to do something in museums that was not really being supported by the directors. So you had that shift. Now what your position is, so like for example, MoCA is not a public institution. The Broad is not a public institution. It's not a public institution. It is by their grace that they give us access to the collection,
yeah.
And it's okay.
Yeah, I mean, let's get real. There's a two-class system of museums, just like
right.
there are many class systems
exactly.
in this country. There are private museums
right.
that are founded often by collectors, private collectors, or come out of a group of collectors, such as what MoCA was. And there are also public institutions. The LA County Art Museum, Museum of Art, is a public institution.
It's a public institution.
So there are public and private. And that's not to say that one is more open or one is more inclusive than the other. It doesn't matter if they're private or public. I know private museums that have made more effort to be inclusive and be democratic than some public institutions. But the point here is that you have to get your history straight and you have to get your ducks in order here, because the whole issue of what happened with Jeffrey Deitch actually it's a violation of a contract with a private board of directors, and there were stipulations made about what he was supposed to do and not do as having been a former art dealer and gallerist. So now, you can say he violated public trust, yes, in quotes, but he also violated a contract that he actually had with the Board of Trustees. So,
but that only came to the attention when we protested outside.
I think it was
I think that if we didn't protest outside, and I don't know if you guys know, but a group of us street artists protested the Contemporary Art Show, the Museum of Contemporary Art Show, because it wasn't inclusive.
Right, but there are two different issues. One is the issue of Jeffrey Deitch, and there was dissent about him long before Art in the Streets. I just want to put that out there. There were problems with Jeffrey Deitch from the beginning. Let's just say that. But then there's the issue of inclusion, and what the biggest issue that I haven't heard today, that is what we talk about all the time, is does Art of the Streets belong in a
museum?
I mean, let's...
Then how come you're not only representing... For example, if you say you're representing the demographics of the street, why are you not using the people such as Chaka?
Well, is that what they're saying? Or are they saying... No, see, there's a difference between naming something for the sake of
PR,
and the difference between what they say their mission and their purpose is.
But
so, you know,
that was complete conflict.
So what I'm real clear is the thing, but that was not street art. That was a show that had appropriated...
How many people thought that
the
that was
language
street
art?
Of it. People, public relations, it was a big campaign. The public relations firm actually exploited the publicity of the particular show. They were actually exploiting it to make people think, to give off the appearance that it was street artwork.
Right, and I just want to say really, really quickly that that Scratch is not a reaction to Art in the Streets at
right.
all. It's totally separate, and it has everything to do with this book. That
well, but the same particular thing, but I would say
that
I would like to take that value and address it, since this is a major show that addresses street art for as a legitimate form. So my hermetic value is that I would like to address that to bring that dialogue and the discourse and those series of conversations, because if it isn't, I don't think it's responsible.
I'm not sure what you just said.
I'll say this. I think that Art of the Streets, if you're showing artwork of the streets, and these individuals from the K2S show are graffiti artists. They're not gallery artists. They're not Shepard Fairey. They're not Banksy. They're not Barry McGlee, Twist. Yeah. So this show represents street artwork, so what the context is, it's going to have to be hermetically interpreted as the dialogue or the conversation addressing street art.
Well, that's more than you collapsing everything into one conversation, and it's not that simple. Mm-hmm. It's just not that simple. And all I'm going to say to you is, like, I appreciate your work in that it's calling attention to some discussions that haven't occurred. But what I want you to do, as a person who empathizes with what you're saying and doing,
I want
you to get it, like, really flat straight, because here's the deal. There's a couple of things that you've collapsed that are not situated in the right relationships in order for it to really resonate as a different point of view that needs to be heard and validated. So I want you to clean that up
so that we can support it. Yeah,
so we can support it, because what you're saying, like, for example, this is what it is. And you may experience it one way, but that is not what they told me they were doing up in here. This is a show, a collection of art that was curated with a specific emphasis that is not what you said it was. Now, you can experience it
anymore. I'll give you the reason why.
But that's on you.
I'll give you the reason why.
That's on you. But no, wait. The artist didn't say that they wanted to do it. The artist did this because they did it. Now, don't make assumptions about that. Read it, have a conversation, have a dialogue. But don't go saying it's something that they said they weren't doing. That's where we get it blown out of proportion.
And the wonderful thing is that you are in the book and you are on the wall. So I wonder why you can't just get over the Mocha Show.
No, there's one wrong. It's not only just the Mocha Show.
No,
it's not only the Mocha Show.
The performance is one piece and it's all good. The performance is all good. You can do whatever you want inside.
My thing is that I'd like to bring more of a wide interpretation to this.
You can't do that. Let me tell you what you got to do. You got to be accountable for your words. You got to be accountable. You got to be accountable. When you come talking about it as a truth, or you try to present it as a historical fact, you got to make sure the fact is a fact and not just an interpretation of the fact.
Yeah.
You can contextualize it as my version of it, and I got it. I appreciate and support you with the right to say it, but I do not want you to misrepresent it as anything else. I'm more interested in what's going on all over here, and you're about to have. I want to know what all this is.
Well, let's go. Arturo, Arturo the DJ. Arturo, come on out and say hello to you guys.
What's going on over here? You ain't
got to talk to them. Cesar Garcia, Omar.
Arturo!
Who came up? He's actually a performer as well. John is actually a musician. Arturo is a DJ who actually has played with me before. We were actually involved in the protest against Mocha. And his DJ name is DJ Bogalis. So look out for that. Thank you very much. I appreciate your great words and insight. Thank you. I appreciate it. Let's get together and talk. Thank you.
You want to see us have a good one? I want to know why you
betrayed.
Yeah, we want to know why you are a little old lady from Pasadena. A little old white shriveled up prune faced lady.
And why did you have that
costume?
Why this? Why this? I'm dying to know this.
Little old lady from
Pasadena. Is that why this? Why this? Why this?